Good evening. I'm Alan Merton, president of George Mason University. It is an honor and privilege to represent George Mason in many different settings. It is truly an honor and privilege to be with you this evening to give you and all of us an opportunity to hear from two truly great Americans. An evening with Brian Lamb and Richard Norton Smith. An evening with Brian Lamb and Richard Norton Smith. That sounds pretty good. Two people who have been both players in and observers of so much that happens in this country and beyond for sort of good or for evil. What I'll do is just say a few things about both of them, and then I'll step aside and turn it over to Brian, and they'll begin their conversation, and at some point in time, either you'll wear out or they'll wear out, and we'll move on. Richard reminded me that he's teaching tonight. There's one thing about George Mason that when you have prominent people like Richard Norton Smith and their schedule is bounded by the fact that they're teaching a class. We had an event last week and they're supporting our real estate programs, and two of our faculty were not there at dinner time. And I was told the reason they weren't there at dinner time was that the president of the university was forcing them to teach. It was Jim Moran and Tom Davis. They ended up coming after. So the same thing with Richard, we've got to bound what we do based on our teaching responsibilities. I'm not going to spend a lot of time going over their resumes, vitas, et cetera. I did have the feeling when I picked up both of the information on the two of them, I was recalled what I used to do when I ran executive programs at Michigan a long time ago to get people to know each other. I would say to people that we're going to be together for a week or so, I'd say, now what we need to do is for each of you is that we're going to go around a room and each of you say three things about yourself, two of which are true and one of which is false. And the purpose of the group was to find out which the two truths were and which the false was. I'm not going to do that with the two of them. They know each other too well. Brian Lamb is Chief Executive Officer of C-SPAN Networks. He's been at the helm of the Public Affairs Channel since he helped the cable industry launch it 32 years ago on March 19th. 1979. Brian and C-SPAN have made an incredible difference in our lives. As I said to an event earlier this evening, and Sally says to people and to me on a regular basis, I am a C-SPAN junkie. You know, I admit it and I love it. I mean, it's just an opportunity to see what goes on at that level of our country's activities, and to be able to see it yourself, and you to be able to decide who you like, who you don't like, and what parts you would influence you versus what part didn't, as opposed to what we have so many times in other mechanisms. Brian, as many of you know, is a good personal friend. Brian and I have known each other since we were young. We were both military aides to Lyndon Johnson. We also were accompanied by a guy named Charles Robb, who was also an aide with us, and others who have done, let's say, reasonably well post their time with the Johnson White House. We learned a lot in that experience, and in our specific cases, we've been fortunate to maintain our friendship through that long period of time. Richard Norton Smith. I find most interesting about Richard is that to see if I could detect by looking through his resume, how many presidential libraries has he touched? In most cases, ran, so not just touched them. Herbert Hoover, Dwight Eisenhower, Ronald Reagan, Gerald Ford, and Abe Lincoln. So he has done more with the presidential libraries than any other person. And it's several years ago, Brian and I were talking, he said to me, do you know Richard Norton Smith? My answer was, yes, I definitely know who Richard is. He said, Richard is looking to do some different things from just one more presidential library. Is there a way we could involve Richard at George Mason University? And we did, and we're fortunate to have Richard as a scholar in residence. Richard Norton Smith, Brian Lamb, it's yours.
A number of years ago, I met Richard on the set at C-SPAN in a Booknotes program. And I want to show you what he looked like back then and see if there's any comparison with today. There are others on this little clip, and it'll begin a discussion that we can have because the real writer in the room is right here. So let's run this clip, and we'll ask Richard some questions. Clip number two.
The Sally Fairfax has been described as Washington's great love. That may or may not be true. We don't know. She was a young woman of dazzling virtuosity who I think impressed a young man who was terribly self-conscious, not only of his lack of formal education, but his lack of polish.
A couple of points, you talk about the romance between Stephen Douglas and the woman that married Abraham Lincoln?
Mary, right. I'm not sure if I would call it a romance, but I would. That's been exaggerated by films and novels. She cast her eyes on this unlikely fellow who supposedly said to her, "I'd like to dance with you in the worst way," prompting her to say that was exactly the way he danced.
They met at a National Press Club reception for returning GIs from World War II who had been elected to Congress. It was just for veterans. Would all come back from the service about a year before. Billy Sutton, who was press secretary to Jack Kennedy, freshman from Massachusetts, introduced him to Richard Nixon, a freshman from California, and Jack Kennedy said, "You're the guy that beat Jerry Voorhees, aren't you?" And Nixon said, "Yeah." And Kennedy was so impressed that this guy had knocked off the big guy, and Nixon, of course, not very good at small talk, says, "Well, I guess I feel great." You know, that's all he could come up with.
We became the leader of the free world because we were the only ones that could lead. And we did it not, however, as philanthropy, but for ourselves. Because if we don't lead, who else is going to lead today? People say, well, let's let somebody else do it. We've taken the burden. The only other nations capable of leading today who had the resources in the, to do so, potentially, are the Japanese, the Chinese, the Russians, and the Germans. Does anybody want to leave their fate in the hands of those nations and those peoples? No.
You say that your hobby, both of your hobbies, early in your life, was reading.
I read many of the books by your writers, Theodore Dreiser, Scott Fitzgerald, to say nothing of Mark Twain, and Jack London, and I could go on and on.
We have a number of clips we're going to use tonight, but how did you think you looked?
You notice, you know, Gorbachev didn't mention reading Karl Marx.
But what was interesting about that interview, he brought a translator along, a guy named Pavel Palashchenko, who I subsequently interviewed for Booknotes. But he translated for him at the same time he translated for me. And that allowed us to have an hour interview instead of a half hour interview, because if we had had to translate consecutively. But the purpose of running that was not only to see Richard the day that I met him, and since that day I've probably had hundreds of hours of conversations with him. But let's talk about the whole business of writing. You're in the 400.
Well, I thought we were here to talk about the whole business of Booknotes.
We're going to talk about the 437th year that he's been in the middle of writing Rockefeller. Talk about why you write.
Because there's nothing else I can do. No, I mean, why does anyone try to do what they love to do? Not everyone is fortunate enough. I'll never forget one day I was sitting in a green room with David McCullough, who is everyone's favorite historian and a terribly nice person. And it helps that he looks like God. I mean, he really, the older he gets, the more divine he looks. But
sounds like him.
Yeah. But he said out of the blue, and I've never forgotten it, because it goes to the heart of what writers hopefully do. He said, "You know who the real heroes are?" And he said, "They're the people who go to jobs day after day after day that they hate in order to put food on the table and shoes on the kids." And he said it in the tone of someone who had, at least at some point in his life, experienced that. But the point is the empathy. I know that's a loaded word, apparently, in some quarters. It's taken on political connotations that I don't understand. But to me, it's the most unpolitical word possible. Any artist, any musician, any journalist, any writer certainly any biographer or historian is hopefully going to try to cultivate empathy, because it's nothing more or less than the ability to forget yourself for a while and imagine yourself inside someone else's shoes, inside their world, their culture, their conventions. It's an act of imagination and at the same time unimagining things that seems to me to be prerequisite for, and I think probably writing fiction as well.
In the over 22 years that I've been doing this show on Sunday nights, we stopped Booknotes actually about 6-7 years ago, but kept on a program where we often talk with writers. I don't know why, I suppose it's because I don't do it very well, but one of the most exciting things for me to find out is how somebody writes. And I did an interview yesterday, this won't air on the network for 4 or 5 weeks, but I brought along some clips from the interview because I thought it would help everybody in the room think about their own situation. I know I've met some of you earlier. Kristen is an author down here. She's a student at George Mason, has written a book already on George Washington, so she has something in common with our patriarch over here. The woman's name, and a lot of you will know her name, is Stacy Schiff, and she wrote a best-selling book about Cleopatra, but she also wrote 3 other books, one on Vera Nabokov, Vladimir Nabokov's wife. She wrote a book on Ben Franklin, and one other one about a Frenchman, which his name's Saint-Exupéry. You probably know, you know everything. I want to have 3 little excerpts from that interview, because she really did an interesting job of explaining the writing process. Let's watch the first one and get your reaction to it.
I write in an office on 43rd Street in New York City, which has a view of the sky, which is the only, there seem to be only 2 criterion for me for where I can write. And the 2 criteria are a view of the sky and a very large desk, because needless to say, the biographer assembles a lot of paper. And it's, what you're doing is a very synthetic process. You want 90% of that paper, or the contents of that paper, to land on the cutting room floor. But I find I can only work by having it all arrayed in front of me and being able to sort of weave little bits of things from it. And when you ask about Wikipedia, I should have said, Wikipedia and the internet haven't really changed the way I anyway research. I still, and I think most people writing as the kind of things I'm writing, I still go back to the original documents. So you need to be, the archival research hasn't changed except that the finding aids have changed now that things are digitized.
What do you write on?
Oh, you ask the embarrassing question. I write with a pencil on a legal pad for the first draft, and by hand.
Pencil?
A mechanical pencil, because there's something about, I'm a very fast typist. It's one of my few skills, and I type much faster than I write. So I find that when I write something on the computer, first of all, it's longer always. I don't know if everyone notices that. And it's softer somehow. It doesn't have the terseness it could have. So the pencil on the paper slows me down. Once I have a first draft, then I will enter it into the computer, which is already in active editing, and then edit subsequent drafts from there.
I absolutely agree with her about the slowing down. I used to be a speechwriter, and I swear that the brain works differently, and you produce material on a faster pace. And so when you're writing history, biography, or quote, serious, whatever, you literally need to slow down. And so I write with a pen and a legal pad, and then it goes to a typist in Kansas, and she types, and it comes back, and large portions of the vaunted, some would say mythical, Rockefeller manuscript have been through 60 drafts or more to this point. The trick is, in the end, to make it look easy, to make it look as if it was all the first draft.
So what's the atmosphere that you write in, and what time of day?
You know, whenever I can. I wish I was one of those people who sat down every day and did the same thing at the same time, you know, or sat in the same place in a very organized, structured way and spent my morning and knew where I was going to be that afternoon, and I don't work that way. A lot gets written at 1 or 2 in the morning, at the end of the day. The one good thing, I suppose, is so far, knock on wood, it doesn't matter when, good or bad. It doesn't seem to, the timing or even the surroundings. I learned long ago to, you know, I can write on airplanes. I am technologically illiterate. I don't know how computers work.
Do you have one in your home?
No. There's one at a UPS store across the street, which is getting rich off of my occasional patronage. And I do worry about, and I have, by the way, first of all, you don't write books, you rewrite books. But by the way, it's interesting that she likes A View. I find that really interesting in a number of ways. My literary hero, Somerset Maugham, had a famous place on the Riviera and a writing room at the top of the villa. And his desk was very deliberately backed up against the wall where there was no view to avoid the distractions of the Mediterranean. I don't know what she sees out her window, but.
Alan Merton is already in the process of writing his memoir from the time he spent here at George Mason. Isn't that right, Alan? Where are you?
Yes, yes.
Let's go back to Stacy Schiff, another clip on here. We continued to talk about the way she writes and where she writes and all that stuff. How long did you research Cleopatra?
I think I spent 3 years on the research with this book and about a year and a half on the writing. And I thought this would be a fast book to research because obviously there are no archives, there was no one to interview. There was very little travel other than Egypt. Most of the travel was to and from the New York Public Library, in fact. But what I ended up finding was that the secondary materials were, first of all, immensely helpful, and secondly, endless. So that I would go down a road on, say, education in the Hellenistic world. It was very easy to recreate what Cleopatra had read and how she had been educated. But you could read the ancients on that subject for a very long time. There were little bits and pieces in odd places. Josephus has great things on Egypt and on the layout of Herod's palace that I needed to incorporate. So I kept going off on different tangents. And then, as I say, I spent a lot of time reading about the chroniclers themselves, finding out who these men were, and that took quite a while as well.
How much of the book do you write at the same time? In other words, nonstop writing in the book instead of research?
I usually try to do all of my research, insofar as one can ever do all of one's research before I start writing. And it's only at the point where I feel that I can see the book taking shape, I know where it starts, I know at least where it opens, and I'm beginning to see the themes of the life emerge that I start writing. And also, of course, there's usually a deadline at the back of my mind, so I'm realizing that should be happening sooner rather than later at a certain point. And only then do I start writing. And once I'm launched, ideally, I don't stop. I can still be researching in the afternoons. You always get to a point where you realize that there's something you forgot to research. With the Franklin book, I had written a chunk of it before I realized that there were things about the American Revolution in America that I needed to know, because I was writing about it from the French side, obviously. And I went back and did those in the afternoons while I was writing in the mornings. But I, anyway, find that once I'm launched and I'm writing, I want to be at it every day if possible, at least 6 days a week, and I can't really let it go.
She's lucky. She didn't have to do oral history, you know? Well, on the Rockefeller book, for example, I have sitting in my apartment 65,000 pages of primary source material that I've taken out of various archives, but then I've supplemented that with 160 interviews. And that would not be a problem with Cleopatra. There aren't many people to talk to.
She said that she researched for 3 years and then wrote for a year. How about you?
Oh, gosh.
Lay down the number of years you've been working on this book.
Well, this book is 11 years in the making. And I have 850 pages done. And I have 300 to go. I'll be done in a year. And then 100 pages of notes, 2,000 footnotes.
She said she does all her research and then writes. How about you?
No, I do it. The first book I did, the Dewey book, I did a biography of Governor Dewey of New York, the man who almost became president and who was the great gangbuster in the 1930s. And I was very young. I moved from Washington to Rochester, New York, and spent all day, 9 a.m. to 5 o'clock, in a library carrel going through boxes of paper, and then we'd go home and write all night. And that book, which is 700 pages long, was researched and written in 18 months, which is obscene, and will never happen again. I lost a year. It turned out to be a useful year, but nevertheless, a year when I tore up the first 70,000 words that I'd written, because they opened 120 boxes marked family and friends. And that's the good stuff, you know, including 400 letters, handwritten letters, from the first Mrs. Rockefeller, who has never really been covered in any depth. And so it was worth what it took, but it does mean that it's a work in progress.
Let's go back one more time to Stacy Schiff, who worked as an editor at Simon & Schuster and also at Viking for about 9 total years. She has 3 children and a husband who lives in Canada, and she lives in New York. She is also very active on the book circuit right now. Do you like to go on book tours?
Nobody likes to go on book tours.
Why not?
Do you want an honest answer?
Yeah.
Because no one shows up.
Let's just leave that alone, right? Let's go back. Let's go to the clip. Clip 16 on Stacy Schiff and see what more she has to say. I can't believe that no one would show up for you. Look at the crowd you got tonight. What time of the day do you start?
As early as I can push the children out the door in the morning. And I'm usually good till the caffeine wears off, so around 1 or 2 in terms of the writing. So I can get a good 3 or 4 hours of writing in. That used to mean 3 or 4 pages. With the last book, it was about a page and a half at the most. It was a page or a page and a half a day, which was partly that I was so carefully parsing the little materials I had. It was such tiny fragments. Very much like the Nabokov book, I was working from tiny fragments.
Do you work in silence?
I usually listen to classical music. With the Franklin book, I listened to opera because it seemed somehow as if it were an operatic story. Franklin himself was outsized. Beaumarchais was running in and out of the tale. Everything about it seemed as if it lent itself to opera, to grand opera and often comic opera. With everything else, it's been pretty much a steady diet of Mozart and Bach.
Now, you used to be an editor.
That's right.
At Viking and Simon Schuster. How many books do you think you edited over the years?
That's a really good question. Maybe 50 or maybe 10 a year at the most, the very most, so no more than 50.
So you've done 4 books. Have they all had an editor?
They have all had a different editor, interestingly, yes. I have never published with the same editor twice.
Is it harder or easier to have been an editor when you're now a writer?
It's harder because you wish you could do it for yourself. I mean, it's like giving yourself a massage. I mean, you know it needs to be done, and you just can't see anything. You've lost all perspective. So I know where the editor should step in. On the other hand, my resentment of the editor for fixing something is no less than it would be had I not been an editor in the first place. So you're thrilled to have this person poring over your prose. On the other hand, there's always that sort of tussle back and forth about what needs to be in the manuscript. It's very hard to part with something where you've spent a lot of time, where you've spent a lot of time tracking it down. And sometimes I think the biographer falls prey to his own travails of research.
Stacy Schiff is the kind of person that you like to interview because she's full of life. She's willing to share with you the details on how she does things like writing. And she's also a bit mischievous. She's full of fun and all that stuff. It doesn't quite come out in the interview. But those are, like Richard, and actually I've talked with all these characters. And yes.
Tell me. Yes. I'm not asking for a name.
Yes, sir.
You've just described, in some ways, the kind of author you enjoy talking to. Have you had an experience where, for example, there are people who write beautifully, but for whatever inexplicable reason, are not nearly as good articulating it verbally? Have you had people who you found it almost impossible to interview?
You were one of the most difficult interviews ever.
Having set the standard,
yeah.
I think I could ask you.
Of course. And there are all kinds of experiences for an interviewer, including fabulous people that just exude all kinds of fun and interest and information. And then there have been some great book writers who are terrible. I'll tell you who's a hard interview. This is not a negative on him, is Tom Clancy. He doesn't really like, he doesn't like to talk. And I remember, there I have a clip, I doubt if we'll have time to get to it, but he just, that's just, the, I think, the thing that he enjoys the least. I think he only does it because he has to. Apologize to you, Tom, if I've just exaggerated, but he's an interesting man. That is not the point.
Right.
But yeah, and also if people give you one sentence answers, and that can be very difficult on an interviewer because you want them to tell their story. Go back to the editor that she talked about in there, and she was an editor. You've had one of the most significant editors in the last 50 years. Tell us about him.
Yeah, well, I've had two in the course of my career who are almost household names. At the very beginning, I had Alice Mayhew at Simon & Schuster, who is a larger-than-life figure, probably her best known for Woodward and Bernstein and the Bob Woodward book since, loves Washington books. And then more recently, for the last 10 years, Bob Loomis, who at Random House, who is the last of his breed, someone who you can imagine sitting around the Algonquin Round Table with Maxwell Perkins and Scott Fitzgerald, you know, and holding his own. And at the age of 85, Bob has decided it's time to cut back. And but I'm actually very fortunate in the replacement that I have.
I'm not a writer, and I'm absolutely fascinated by the whole experience and wording and all that. And I wanted to have the whole book experience. So I decided to, you know, I got an agent and we put a book together. We took the interviews from Booknotes and took the questions out and made little essays out of them. And this was over 11, 12 years ago, and the book was going to be, I asked in there at the end, where's the book going to be printed? I wanted to go see the printing of the book, and it was printed at R.R. Donnelly out in Harrisonburg, Virginia. And I said, I'm going out to see it. And I called, and the guy said, sure, come on out. The day we print it, you can come in and watch it. So I drove out there. I went into the print factory, and I watched this process. And I asked, the guy's name, his first name was Jeff, and I said, Jeff, I was so excited about this. I saw the book come off and bound and covered and everything else. And I said to Jeff, how many, and they were huge names, authors all over the place. I said, how many of these authors have come out here and seen this process? And he looked at me and he said, well, I've been here 13 years and you're the first one. So I realized at that point I had become a fanatic. And a friend of mine was telling the story to a dinner guest one night that I had gone out, you know, and done this. And he said, well, why did, you know, when you're on, when, and she went out with me to watch this. And he said, well, why didn't you ask him to pull off the side of the road somewhere and just watch grass grow for a couple of hours?
You know what? It's very simple. You're interested in how things work.
Yes.
Including authors.
But authors have, it would almost be like, one of the things I'd always want to do in my life and never will do because I haven't got the patience is to learn how to play the violin. But, and I'll never be a big author. And I think that is such a magic business that being able to watch it is just fascinating.
Were you a big reader as a kid?
No.
When did you become this interested in books?
About 45 years old. I know I don't look much older than that.
And so when C-SPAN began, C-SPAN went on the air when?
79.
And Booknotes was?
88. As a matter of fact, let's stop just a second. I want to show you a clip, the first one up here, number one, Alex. And you'll see the very first interview in 1988 that started the whole process of Booknotes and actually books on C-SPAN, which Connie Debley is here tonight, and she started our, what was it, about books that you started?
About books and books.
And then Book TV, yeah, and responsible for the whole Book TV thing on the weekend that we do. Alex, are you there, big guy? Go.
As a reporter, never could escape from Vietnam. I went there first it was my first assignment in 1962 as a wire service reporter. I spent 2 years there. And then one day found myself at Arlington Cemetery at the funeral of a friend, John Vann, and realized that I wanted to leave something behind other than another magazine article and another newspaper story.
You did one of the last interviews with John Kennedy.
Yeah.
In 1963, and one of the things you talked about was Vietnam.
I sensed that he was fed up with Vietnam at that point. He was fed up with the leadership, the civilian leadership of Vietnam, remarked upon it at some length, and I just feel that he would have gotten out.
In the book, I relate that I talk about the protesters, and I had great sympathy for the protesters. One day, I believe it was 1965, a man burned himself to death in front of my window, below my window. His name was Morrison. He, as the flames were consuming him, he had a child in his arms, and passersby were observing this, and they shouted, they screamed, "Save the child." He threw the child out of his arms. The mother of the child, the wife of Morrison, wrote me a note. And I'd like to read it, if I can. It's a beautiful, beautiful letter. And she says, "To heal the wounds of war, we must forgive ourselves and each other, and we must help the people of Vietnam to rebuild their country. I'm grateful to Reverend McNamara for his courageous and honest reappraisal of the Vietnam War and his involvement in it. I hope his book will contribute to the healing process."
That sounded more like Robert McNamara telling viewers that they should forgive him than that he should forgive himself.
That particular interview was incredibly important in a lot of ways for me. And I had worked in his Pentagon in the Navy when I was there. And I must say that when I was there, the government was not telling the truth on the war. And so to be there, he teared up. I think I counted 8 times during the interview. But here was the most interesting thing to me. This won't mean much to any of you. He showed up at the door. He had no idea who I was. This was the day that the Oklahoma City bombing of the Murrah building. And that had happened right in that same period of time. And I don't remember if we knew it before or after. It may have happened just when we were recording this in the morning. And the first thing he said to me, he's a very nice man to me. And he said to me, "Before we begin this interview, can you tell me what C-SPAN is?" Now, this was the mid-90s. We've been in business since 79. He lived in Washington, D.C. There was cable there since the mid-80s. He had no idea. He'd never watched it. He didn't know what we did. He was a man in his last 20 years probably consumed with what you saw there on the screen. This was the book that he wrote in which he basically admitted that he had made mistakes. But that whole series there was starting with Neil Sheehan. Neil Sheehan took 16 years. You still have a couple years left before you have to complete Rockefeller. And he had a writing block in the middle of it. He had a major automobile accident that put him up for a year in that process. His wife wrote about it in the New Yorker magazine. And Walter Cronkite was talking about an issue that still is today sensitive. Did Jack Kennedy want to stop the war? Would he have continued it? And you can get in, as you know, as a historian, you can get into a real good argument about Lyndon Johnson and those that want to blame Lyndon Johnson for the war, or those that want to blame Kennedy for the war, or those who want to, depending on what side you're on. So that was one of the major reasons that Booknotes started, the whole issue of Vietnam, which has played a major role in my personal life, just having been there and in the service at the time. And then from my positions, played a major role on this country that we're still suffering from.
There is a genre of Washington memoir. And they're bipartisan, and they go back a long time. and the most skillfully done managed to conceal the transparency of the motive behind them. And I could think of some current examples. Can you think of a Washington memoir that worked, that really was effective, and had a life beyond the immediate controversies that it purported to describe?
I don't know how much of a life it will have, because it's not that old, but a memoir, and I interviewed this fella who's no longer alive for this book, but it was an incredibly, in my opinion, he's a very controversial figure, but it was incredibly honest, was Robert Novak. Novak's book tells you how much money he made when he worked for CNN. He tells you who his sources were. Most of them, fortunately for the sources, were gone. But he told it like it happened from his perspective, and that whole business about the Valerie Plame and all that stuff was right in the middle of that. And of course, then he had brain cancer after that. That's just one. I can't think of any that I can. I know a lot of them that do not tell the full story. I'll give you an example. And I like the man, Walter Cronkite, wrote a memoir. Nobody told this story except Frank Mankiewicz. And Frank Mankiewicz, the nephew of Joseph Mankiewicz, who did Cleopatra, Frank Mankiewicz, not too long ago, within the last couple years, did a column in the Washington Post in which he said that Walter Cronkite came to Robert Kennedy back in the middle of the Vietnam War and in the 60s and begged him to run for president. No one had ever admitted that until Frank Mankiewicz, for whatever reason, decided to write it in a Washington Post column. I called up Mr. Mankiewicz and said, would you come in and spend an hour and let's talk about this, which we did, and it's available to watch on our website where we have our video library. So I'm wary of memoir myself, just based on not just that story, but you tell your story, and I think they're valuable and they're worth reading, but I'm always wary of what's left out.
You have interviewed presidents. We saw a clip of Richard Nixon. What was that like? Anything about it surprise you?
Oh, yeah. I will never forget. Richard Nixon came into the studio. We did 2 one-hour shows, one in the morning, one in the afternoon. He went back to his hotel room. He had a cottage cheese and whatever else he ate and his ketchup.
With ketchup.
With ketchup, yeah. Took a nap. He was in his late 70s. And changed his shirt, he told me. Changed his tie. Same exact tie, but changed it. And came back in the afternoon. Here's what I most remember from the Richard Nixon interview, and that is I had seen him in person once, in passing in the hallway in the White House. I kept thinking, oh, he's here, he's in the studio, he's right in front of me. I had seen him on television forever, all my entire life, and he's, you know, the jowls and the whole thing, and he's talking, he's right here, I can reach out and touch him. And I remember thinking, this is really strange. I had the same experience with Mr. Gorbachev, the thing that I learned most from interviewing him, besides just being around him, and I had the pleasure of, when he first got there, he needed to go to the bathroom, so I had to walk him through our engineering department to get to the bathroom. And he was fighting with us. He only wanted to give us a half hour, and he ended up giving us the hour that we needed. But I learned that he didn't speak any English. And you know how you see presidents standing with these leaders all over the world, and they're talking back and forth?
Yeah.
He couldn't understand a word. They have the photo ops. They go out by themselves. There's no translators around. But I did learn from him that his daughter spoke English. These little things are fun and interesting and don't necessarily tell you much about world power. But
you interviewed Margaret Thatcher.
I did.
What was that like? Did she have any small talk?
None. None.
Was she trying?
No.
No.
No, she was heavily managed, and she had these attendants around her, and you know, you didn't dare you know, you just basically shut your mouth until the interview was over. You asked her questions and left. I mean, it was very managed. And as a matter of fact, it was, I interviewed her twice. One time was really dissatisfying or anyway, she agreed to several interviews, and they set it up at the embassy, and they let us, we had to set our equipment up in the same room with several other journalists. And so she would come to us for 20 minutes and the next journalist and the next journalist, and all the journalists could sit in the room and listen to you ask questions of her before they got to, so you didn't have anything exclusive in the end. The other time for Booknotes, I interviewed her, that was in a private place somewhere because she was no longer prime minister. And that was much better, but she still was, she's very regal. She would fit into the queen status in your life, yeah.
She would expect you to curtsy to her.
Yeah. We better open it up to questions if anybody, because I know we're running out of time, if anybody in this audience wants to ask Richard.
All through the years as you were putting Booknotes together, was there a particular process that you used as you read books, as you made your notes? By the way, for those of you who don't know, Brian has donated that collection here to the George Mason Library. So if you didn't know and you have a chance to get over there, you should really see them there. There's something special. But I'm wondering if there was something in particular that you did, setting-wise, time-wise, what have you, as you prepared for all of these interviews.
Well, I didn't read a book like you're normally supposed to read it. I don't know. I never ask you how you read a book. I would first pick up a book and go to the back, to the acknowledgement section, to find out where the connections were. There are always connections. There are, you know, Guggenheim fellowships and so-and-so, my best friend did this for me and read this book, and it is always amazing what's in the acknowledgements. Then I usually read the last chapter. And it all depended on what kind of time pressures I had. I've always said I read 75% of these books cover to cover, and then 25% of them I had time pressures, and so I couldn't get to them. And the trick, if you can't get to them, is you read the first page of every chapter, just so you know where they went. Because every author will tell you on that first page basically what's in that chapter. But I like always to read the whole book, because I would find on page 379 a little nugget that in some cases the author didn't even intend for you to see. My old friend Jack Nelson, who used to run the LA Times Bureau here, wrote a book. It was a very interesting book about, my memory was about Jews in Mississippi, and Jack was a great civil rights advocate and all that stuff. But in the book, for some reason or other, Jack said that he had a drinking problem and he drank too much. So in the middle of the, I knew him very well too, and in the middle of the interview, I said, Jack, tell us about your drinking problem. For the rest of his life, sadly he's not with us, for the rest of his life, every time I'd see him, he'd say, you know what this guy did to me one time? And I would say, Jack, you put it in the book. I do think, you tell me if I'm wrong, or Tom or Jack, I do think that some authors write books and they're on the third floor, back in the corner. It's a room that's only they go into. They sit in there like you do, writing your thing out and all this stuff, and they really don't think about who will read this and what they will read. Because I swear to goodness, I'm the first person to have read their book and asked them questions about it, and they're always so shocked that, why would you ask me about that? David Cassidy of the, Crosby, of the Crosby, Stills, and Nash Group, wrote a biography. I can't tell you why he even did it.
It's probably about nothing but his drinking problem.
No, actually, it was about providing the necessary human needs to Miss Etheridge for her child, and I said, you know, why did you do that? And he said, I won't talk about that.
He was drunk at the time.
I don't associate myself with his. But I said to him, I said, Mr. Cassidy, you put that in your book. Why can't you answer it? You know, and that happens all the time. So the trick in getting ready for any of these is to be able to read the whole book. But if you can't read the whole book, begin with beginning and end, and then acknowledgments and the introduction and the preface and all that stuff, and then do the best you can to get through the rest of the book. But and I used to read at 3 o'clock in the morning till 6 and then go to work. And I would also read on Saturday nights, shows you what an exciting life, until until I married my lovely wife, Victoria. And she hates it when I say this. Should I say that? No, you don't want me to say that. People always ask me why I gave up on book notes, and I said because I got married, and Vicky goes nuts. And who else has a question?
Richard, what do you get by watching Brian do an interview? What do you learn from his interview that you don't get from the book? What does he bring out of the interview?
It's true that he does ask questions that are, I hate to use the word procedural, but seriously, that you know, the typical, we talk about a book tour. I said no one's showing up. I meant no one shows up mentally. People show up physically, but most interviewers.
That may be in your case, but when I went on a book tour, it was well, physically.
but basically someone is, quote, interviewing you who's not read the book, who has no intention of reading the book, who might have glanced at some PR material, you know, 5 minutes beforehand. I mean, it's a very superficial, and you're glad, frankly, you're glad to be noticed at all. Brian, on the other hand, not only, I mean, sort of enters into, or I think really tries to experience the book as much as possible from the author's own outlook. What is it that made you give up X amount of your life? What passion drove you to do this? And if you can communicate that to the audience, I mean, that's the best kind of interview.
And we have frankly have been
one
lucky.
One more question.
That's Cynthia, I can't see. Is that you, sir?
It is. You say that you didn't really become much of a reader until around age 45, but as you were reading for book notes, did you reflect on those things, those ideas, those authors, the history that you had missed or hadn't affected you at an earlier age?
Oh, I think, and I don't think this matters to many people, but I it had all this reading has had a tremendous impact on me. I mean, when I was in college, I read all that, and I wasn't ready to learn, and I didn't, you know, it was just the wrong time for me. And but then I really, because I had lived here in this town for a long time, I moved here in 1966, and I've lived here ever since. And trying to figure out this system of government and why it is what it is and the checks and the balances, as Alan was talking about, all this stuff, I found this to be incredibly rewarding. And as a matter of fact, I'll say this, my thinking about the country and about our system has been a roller coaster ride. It's never been static. And one day you know, as I think about all, I say, isn't this terrific? And the next day I'll think, this isn't working right. But, you know, you go back, everybody loves to talk about the founders. Well, I've had a real good course in it, not like he has, but I've had a real good course in it by reading all these books and trying to, you know, I didn't know anything about Democracy in America, the Tocqueville book, and I ended up interviewing Alan Riding, who had written the introduction to Everybody's Library's version of that. And that opened up for us, Rob Kennedy's here from C-SPAN, opened us for us a 55 city tour where Tocqueville went when he was here in the 1820s. But that's been the fun thing is being able to, you saw Harold Holzer on the Lincoln-Douglas debates there in that clip. We asked the 7 cities in Illinois where the Lincoln-Douglas debates were held to recreate them for us exactly as they happened back in 1858, and they agreed to do it. And all of that came out of this idea of just trying to get to the bottom of what people were talking about in the daily press. I mean, reporters would write, what we need for this country are Lincoln-Douglas debates. Well, if you want to ensure that nobody pays any attention whatsoever to politicians at all, do the Lincoln Douglas debate style of debate today. It wouldn't work. It was a debate for the times. It might be interesting to a small audience, and we'd be glad to cover it, but the average American wouldn't stay there for 3 hours under any circumstances. And one person would have as much as 60 minutes to make a speech, and then a rebuttal and all that. So for me, though, it's been a tremendous education. I just hope, and I have to say, Kristen, who I met earlier, who has already, she's a sophomore here at George Mason, studying geography and maybe even studying presidential politics, told me earlier that watching C-SPAN through her earlier years made a big difference in her life and got her interested in this stuff. That's why we do what we do. I mean, there are some C-SPAN veterans in the audience, and I can tell you that's why they get up every day and do it.
Well, Richard, have the last word.
Yeah, let me ask you, do you worry about the current and prospective state of literacy in America, and particularly historical literacy? Because history is a subject that Booknotes and C-SPAN pays a lot of attention to.
I actually don't worry about it. I'll tell you why, because if you'd seen me when I was 20 years old, you'd have worried about me. No, I don't worry about it. I do think that things are changing, but we have twice as many people in the United States than we had when I was born, and there still are millions and millions that are deeply interested in this. You get a sense that they aren't, just based on what we see and what we see focused on in so much of the media, but that's what sells. And but I don't, I mean, that's not my job to worry about that. That's your job.
thank you, Brian. Thank you very much.